MLB on TuneIn Live, on demand.
Ned Colletti joins us. Hey, Ned, it's Holden and Blummer. How are you?
Gentlemen, how
What's
are you
up,
doing?
What's up, Ned?
Hey there, doing, Blummer. What's happening?
Doing Living the dream. Great. I mean, this
exactly.
is... Did you enjoy this time of year here a couple weeks ago to the trading deadline, or did you have a chance to enjoy it, or was it all just a big blur every year?
I loved it. I tell you what, the last 48 hours are the best, and then the last day is even better, and then the last hour is like being on Wall Street. I mean, it's like big time. It's cool. It's cool.
I love it. That's good to hear. What's the best trade you ever made?
Oh, boy. We could do the worst ones a lot easier. No,
I was trying to help you out
probably,
there, Ned.
Probably. When we acquired Manny Ramirez and the Red Sox on the deadline of 08, and the deal came together really the morning of the 31st, and I had talked to Theo Epstein earlier. He called me about 2 weeks before about Andy LaRoche. And I didn't understand why he needed Andy LaRoche, because he had Mike Lowell. He had third base pretty much covered. And then he had Euclid. And so about a day before, he calls me again on LaRoche. And I says, Theo, what do you got, Cookie? He said, well, I got a three-way working, and I don't know if it's going to happen or not. And then I see on the bottom line, I see he's going to send Manny to Florida. Pittsburgh is going to send Jason Bay to Boston. And both Florida and Boston are going to give prospects to the Pirates. So he calls me back the next day, and I said, hey, congratulations. I see you got this thing moving with Manny. And he goes, I don't think it's going to happen. And I went down after the game, and Joe Torre was managing for us. And I said, Joe, we had a deal with Greg Maddux. I was kind of sitting on the side with San Diego. And went to Joe, and I said, hey, I got a crazy thought for you. I says, you manage this guy in the All-Star game, and you manage against him. What about Manny Ramirez? And he looked at me. He says, you're kidding me. I says, I'm not telling you I'm going to get a call back. But the tone of Theo's voice and a little bit of desperation, because Manny had run his course in Boston at that point in time, I says, you never know. I just wanted to plant the seed with you so you could think about it, because tomorrow morning he's going to go by in a flash. And about 5 in the morning, Theo texted me, and he says, call me right away. And we started to work towards a deal. But we also had the asterisk next to our franchise, because we had no money. And so I had to get Theo and the Red Sox to pay about $7.5 million left on Manny's contract to come here. Had 19 homers, 50-some RBIs in 2 months. Hit almost 400. I think he hit 396 for 2 months. And he just changed our franchise. We had a lot of good young players. We had Martin. We had Kemp. We had Loney. Broxton Billingsley had that whole group that was just really in that a year or so in the big leagues. Didn't really know how to win yet. And they watched him for a couple months, and off they went. So that would probably be one, because it kind of changed the franchise around.
Ned Colletti, take me a little bit deeper into that, because this is a fascinating deal. You're learning, or you're seeing things, reports about a certain deal, so you got that. Second of all, ownership on your side is in complete flux. And Theo has to go to his side ownership, I'm sure, to try and get that cleared. Plus, doesn't the commissioner's office have to clear that? Like,
oh yeah, at let's go Pacific time. 1 o'clock is the deadline Pacific. From about 12:40 till the stroke of 1 o'clock, we're on the phone with the commissioner's office, and it was Neil Huntington and his ownership, Theo and his ownership, and Frank McCourt and myself going through this with the commissioner's office, because everybody had to sign off on it. And I had to say, here's what the Dodgers are doing. We're sending, it was Andy LaRoche and Brian Morris to Pittsburgh or to Boston for Manny Ramirez and $7 million such and such dollars. And then Theo said, this is what the Red Sox are doing. We're sending Manny and the money. We're acquiring Jason Bay. And they sent, I think, Brandon Moss and maybe Eric Hansen, I can't recall exactly, to Pittsburgh. And then Neil said what he was doing, sending Bay to Boston. So all of this stuff had to be okay by the commissioner's office, obviously, because of the money exchanging hands, plus reporting the deal. And so it was so complicated and so many different things going on, and trying to get everybody on the phone at the same time in a conference call. And I believe it was Rob Manfred that was obviously the right-hand man to Commissioner Selig at the time that kind of shepherded through at the buzzer. And I remember getting out of the room and going to tell my staff, and we had one of the baseball shows on television, and they were saying, oh, the Red Sox got stuck with Manny. They couldn't move Manny. We thought they was moving him to Florida, and they couldn't move. They're stuck with Manny. And they talked about it for an hour. because, as Blummer may know, you know, you gotta really inform the players too of what's going on. Manny knew because Manny had a no trade clause, so he had to approve that. But we had to find the guys that we moved. Pittsburgh had to find Jason Bay. Red Sox had to find a couple minor leaguers that they sent in the deal, because I never wanted a player hearing it from anybody but myself. So you got to track guys down, minor league players, you got to find them wherever they're at that time of day, and off you went. So a lot of cool things happened that last day. It's an amazing, amazing time. I did 2 3-way deals in my Dodger career as a GM, both with Theo, one with Seattle and one with Pittsburgh.
That's great stuff. I actually appreciate the fact that you said that you're going to go out personally and try and find those players and get that information to them before it hits the wires or ESPN or wherever it is. Nowadays, it seems like everything jumps out of there on Twitter and social media. But this day and age, this year, if you are a franchise, tell me which franchise you would want to be and which starting pitcher, if there is one out there, you would go get, and what would you deal for him?
Oh, boy.
Fantasy land right now.
Question. I'm still an employee of the Dodgers. I can't be tampering with anybody. But, you know, there's a couple names out there that are truly probably number twos for first division type clubs. And I would set my sights high on trying to figure out a way to get somebody who you could, if you're fortunate enough and good enough to get to the month of October, that could really pitch in that atmosphere. As you know, it's different than any other month, and not everybody's made for it. Not everybody's got the stuff for it. There's only a select few that do it. And I always had teams built to win, built to get to the postseason. Through my Giant career, my Dodger career, 19 years, I think we went 10 or 11 times. That was really what we focused in on, were guys. And if you couldn't do that, if they weren't available or the price was so exorbitant, then you try to find somebody that can fill a gap, including relievers, because the bullpen is also, you better have a strong bullpen. You better have guys with courage that can pitch that seventh, eighth, ninth inning, and you better have a lot of them. So it's really a cool time of the year.
Ned Colletti. Well, I'd say it's a cool time of the year for the Dodgers, but you got the Clayton Kershaw situation going on there. What can you give us a statement? What's happening? There's so many mixed messages that are going out there right now. What's going on with Kershaw? And I guess as a follow up, it's like there's no way you can replace this guy. They're going to have to make a move.
Well, there's no way you can replace one of the, if not the best, you know, right in the team picture of two or three guys as the best. He hasn't pitched since the 26th of June. And for Clayton to miss time, it's got to be real. It's got to be serious. He's not somebody that's going to kind of dodge an opportunity to compete. I've had numerous conversations with him where we really got a little bit passionate on both sides about pitching him when he had a hip issue back in 2012 in September. I tried to convince him not to do it and to give us a couple more weeks. He talked me into it. Pitched some short rest during the postseason. Again, he says, you know, I train all winter long for something like this. So when you got that kind of spirit, you know that he's hurting. He's really hurting. So I think right now it's really just a shutdown and let him try and alleviate the pain and then start up the baseball work again. He's not going to do any baseball activities until he's pain-free. He was going to not have to do a rehab start. That hasn't been decided, obviously, because they don't know when he will be back. But obviously if you're going to sit for another week or two and he's made one 60-pitch side work on Sunday, you go from June 26th to some date in August or maybe even the 1st of September, you've got, you know, 60 pitches you've thrown on the side. So, anyway, I think a lot of that stuff will come forward as more information gets known. One thing about injuries, everybody always wants to know what's going to happen and when it's going to happen and when somebody's going to heal. And it's still the practice of medicine. So, they've still got a long time to figure that out. But it's real. Otherwise, he'd be going to the mound the next couple of days.
Yeah, that would be a beautiful thing if that was able to turn around that quickly. But when you're making these trades and you have a ball club that is contending and you're looking for that one extra piece that will hopefully put you over the top, we always talk about talent and what these guys can bring to you on the field. Is there ever a concern when you're making some of these quick decisions on a guy's makeup and how that will affect your clubhouse?
I think it's always in my mind, Blummer. It's always something. I always try to have 25 guys that were just like you, really, that were competitive, passionate about what they did, took nothing for granted. I never had 25 guys. I don't think any team has 25 guys. But you try to do that. And I also would really, really delve into not only who they were through the scouts and what kind of people they are, but really how they would compete in the tough situations. Because when you get to the middle of September, from that point on, everything is so magnified. And you get to October, and the scouting is so precise that if you can't make a pitch in a certain area, or if you're a little bit tentative about competing against a team when you get to that 10th month of the year, you've got no chance. So I always stayed away from players like that. If I needed somebody to get me to October, I would think about it then. But if I needed somebody who I needed to get me to October and to get me through October, the makeup, the character, the intestinal fortitude, and the mental toughness was part of the checkoff list.
Ned Colletti joining us here on MLB on TuneIn Live. Without speaking about players in particular, catchers have been traded midseason before. You've had Mike Piazza, who I think was traded twice in a matter of a couple of days. But a catcher, maybe a big-time catcher being on the move, how challenging is it for a catcher to come over midseason and learn a pitching staff? And how much would that go into a factor when you're making a deal for a catcher?
Well, if you're really in need of a catcher, you're going to have to just live with it, and you're going to have to hope that the catcher's mentality and the catcher's thought process is so good, and he's so good with pitchers that he's going to be a quick read. He's going to learn it quick because it is a lot to understand. It's not just pitches and what a guy can throw and when he throws it, but it's what they look like. What they look like when they're on, what they look like when they're having a little bit of an off night, but also the thought process. I'm sure Blummer's been in a million meetings on the mound. You got to have that thought process with the pitcher and the catcher where they speak the same language. And the catcher's not only got to know how to pitch hitters vis-a-vis a scouting report, but he's also got to know the pitcher's mentality through all sorts of different situations. That takes time. So if you really need a catcher, you're going to have to just hope that it works and give the guy a crash course and the pitching staff. If you really need them, if it's to just make yourself a little better and you've done enough homework on somebody, that's a little bit of an easier decision. I've acquired guys in the middle of the season who are catchers. I picked up a couple guys that were number twos so that their acclimation process would be a little bit less. But you can usually tell there's very few secrets in baseball. So you know who the students of the game are, and you know which catchers are really known for their game calling, the way they handle the staff, and how they go about their daily business as far as preparation goes.
That's good stuff. And with the Clayton Kershaw issue being, kind of a question mark, whether or not he'll be able to come back, if he can, when will he? You guys have a young kid in Urias out there pitching. He went 4 innings today through 77 pitches. Can you talk a little bit about the communication between the general manager and the manager these days when you're trying to handle some young talent and try and extend them through these seasons when you know they have good enough stuff to help out your ball club down the stretch?
Yeah, it's a lot of preparation goes into that. I can go back and really discuss Clayton when he was a young pitcher. I tried to keep him away from the big league staff as long as I could because I knew once they saw him, they were going to want him every day. And we did pitch him one time in Vero Beach against the Red Sox in spring training, and he pitched an inning. And I went down after the game, as I always did, and I was sitting with Joe and Rick Honeycutt, and they go, "When do we get this guy?" it was like there was no patience. I said, well, he has not pitched that much. We looked at all sorts of pitchers. We looked at college-age drafts and how they progressed. And we also looked at high school-age pitchers and how they progressed. If they entered the professional ranks as an 18-year-old, as Clayton did, what was their progression, especially the guys that were of that upper echelon potential. Dwight Gooden was one of the guys I remember looking at and kind of mirroring his progression, trying to figure out what we could do with Clayton without putting Clayton in a tough spot. And so and the same thing probably with Urias, where you're trying to have them increase their innings over 1 year from the next, but 100 innings in the big leagues is not 100 innings at AA or AAA. it ain't close as far as how what the strain is, both physically and your psychological approach to getting big league guys out for his double A or triple A hitters out. Far different deal. So you try to progress it up, and you try to protect him as best you can. I wouldn't always just look at the number of innings, because as you guys know, if you're a pitcher and you've got 8 innings and you've thrown 12 to 16 pitches an inning, that is far easier than pitching 5 innings where you're up to 20, 24, 25, a 30-pitch inning. Those, to me, are where guys get hurt and where you can really put somebody in jeopardy. So I not only checked the total number of innings, but I also checked what I would consider the stress innings to make sure that while the innings may be manageable, that how many stress innings did this young guy go through to get there? And you got to be careful with it, and you got to watch his stuff. And everybody's so super competitive. Very few guys, especially a young guy trying to get established, is going to say, "I'm tired. I can't go back out there. Skip me a start." I mean, those are words you got a 1 in a million chance ever hearing. So you got to kind of guard it yourself, and you got to kind of measure it yourself based on what you've seen from other pitchers, the size of the pitcher, the age of the pitcher, and what the pitcher has done historically leading up to that year, and in that particular year, how many innings and how many tough innings he's had, and what he's going to face going through it. Today, I think that Dave Roberts probably had a decision to make whether they were going to let him go out for the fifth, because he pitched pretty well today. Let him go out for the fifth or hold him at 77 pitches and 4 innings. Probably was a little bit of a thought process there for Doc, and obviously he chose to save him 1 inning. And so that adds up, and as time goes on, you'll find that you may have an extra game or two to do it. In Clayton's case, we actually sent him to the minor leagues for a while, got his feet wet. His control, when you look at his command early in his career, it was 2-1, where he was on a record pace as far as strikeouts to walks this year. You look at his first full year, he was in the 180 range of strikeouts and the 90 range of walks. So it was 2-1. And so he was throwing a lot of pitches. He was trying to get his game under control. So we sent him down, let him take a breath, and then brought him up, because when he's in the minor leagues, you can also manage his innings. For example, Urias threw 1 inning since they sent him down 3 weeks ago. So you can kind of manage it a little bit better there and save them. Because the one thing I was always leery about was getting to the end of a season with somebody with immense talent and having them exceed their what you had set forth as their pitch total, their innings pitch total, or their stress inning combination total, and then have to get to October and say, "We don't want them to go anymore." But yet now you're sitting down one of the best guys you've got. Washington did it a few years ago with Strasburg, I think. So you got to kind of manage it, and I would always manage it. So if we did get to October and if his stuff was good enough and his mind worked in that competitive way that you need to work in that type of an environment, that I always saved enough to make sure that if we did need him in October, we still have him.
Awesome stuff, Ned. Always great hearing from you, man. You take care of yourself, all right?
All right, guys.
Thanks, Ned.
Catch up with you soon.
Talk to you soon.
All right, Ned Colletti, who hopefully will be back on the air here sooner than later.
It's MLB on TuneIn Live, weekdays at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Tune in. Listen like you mean it.